Let us make a joyful noise. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
From where does my help come?
My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive me all my sins, and grant me the power of your Holy Spirit, that I may end my sinful life.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you of all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, then, and by his authority, in his stead, and because he has commanded me to, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, our Father, our Creator and Redeemer, by your call you have made us a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Give us the faith and joy to pray for the salvation of all people and to live holy lives in the forgiveness of our sins. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
The Old Testament reading is from the 19th chapter of Exodus. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain, while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation." These are the words you shall speak to the people of Israel. So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
epistle lesson is from Romans chapter 5. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare to even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more will we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Death in Adam, life in Christ. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men, because all sinned. For sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We rise. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus taught them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things?" They said to him, "Yes." And so he said to them, "Therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess our faith this morning in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. The Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets, and I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. In our epistle lesson today, in the 12th verse, it says, "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned." So I wrote, immunized. A minister one time did a study of the Bible and the world in which we live, and he determined that there are 726 different types of sin that we commit. He soon regretted his study when he was besieged with requests for his list by people who thought they were missing something. It is sure hard to make a Lutheran laugh at 11 o'clock in the morning. He was besieged with requests for his list. They didn't know about those sins. And that is the way that sin works. We know how deadly it is, and yet we are fascinated by it. Why would anyone sin if it wasn't fun? If sin was a chore, would we get involved with it? We sin because it's fun and it looks fascinating. We know how deadly it is, and yet we're fascinated by it. It's like we feel like we can charm sin like a cobra by looking it in the eye and playing our flute. But sin is not like mesmerizing a cobra by looking at it in the eye. It's not going to do our bidding. Instead, it's like holding a tiger by the tail that will soon devour us. In the days of the Spanish conquistadors, Europeans made regular trips to the empire that they were building in Mexico. On one of these voyages sailed the famous explorer Hernando Cortes, who was credited with having defeated the mighty Aztec Empire. But how did a small band of perhaps, and I've read up to 500 conquistadors, how did 500 Spanish explorers manage to defeat Montezuma's empire? I've read of up to 9 million people. Of course, it depends on who's doing the study and what their agenda was and what they're trying to make you think, but I've read anywhere up to 9 million was Montezuma's empire. How could 500 men possibly defeat 9 million? Was it because they had guns and gunpowder? Now, I, for one, don't believe that they would have been able to load those crude weapons fast enough to stave off any attack, even by 10,000, much less 9 million. So how did the Spanish defeat the great Montezuma and his Aztec warriors? A lot of the other tribes that the Aztecs were oppressing in the area were willing to join Montezuma to get rid of the Aztecs. I realize that. But the Spanish had a far greater weapon than explosive artillery with them. It seems that on one of Cortez's ships was a cabin boy named Juan, who was afflicted with smallpox. Although the Europeans had been exposed to the smallpox virus for centuries, the Native Americans had nothing or knew nothing of it. So within a short time after being exposed to the cabin boy Juan, after the first infection, smallpox spread like wildfire among the whole population of Aztecs. And so eventually, this little boy, without meaning to, caused the death of around, some say, up to 3 million people. The devastation was even worse in the Incan civilization in South America. We are told that once they were exposed to the smallpox virus, it is estimated that between 60 and 90% of the population of Incas died of the pox. Smallpox has a long history, almost as old as sin itself. The oldest reference that we find in reference to the smallpox is in the ancient Egyptian records. It is said that the pharaoh Ramses V died of smallpox in the year 1157 BC. The smallpox virus reached plague proportions in the cities of Europe by 710 AD. Watching family members die from the plague was a common occurrence, and the pox didn't distinguish between classes. We know that it killed 5 reigning monarchs in Europe during the 18th century. Even now, with the pox that we have in the world today, we saw Boris Johnson, the Prime Minister of the UK, get deathly sick. So the pox and the plague don't distinguish between classes. On the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, the native populations of North and South America were decimated by smallpox and war. Some say reducing their numbers from 72 million when Columbus got here to just around 600,000 by 1800. Epidemics occurred in the North American colonies again and again throughout the 17th and the 18th century. And according to the Centers for Disease Control,
smallpox has probably killed more people in the history of the world than all other infectious diseases combined. Smallpox. They estimate that upwards of 300 million people have died from this disease over the centuries. And now we don't worry at all about smallpox. As dreadful as this is, the death of 300 million people, or the extinction of maybe up to 90% of a certain population, caused by one little cabin boy one, it doesn't even compare to the devastation caused by one man, Adam. Even though Adam didn't mean to, his act of disobedience spread like wildfire to the whole human race. Even though he thought his sin was a private affair, even though he was, quote, or it was, quote, nobody else's business, what he did with his own body, his decision had devastating consequences of the whole human race, Europe, Africa, Asia, and the Americas alike. His transmission of the sin pox to all of humanity has spared no one. It causes death in everyone. No one gets out of here alive. Did you know that? No one gets out of here alive. The mortality rate is 100%. We are all infected with the sin pox. We manifest the symptoms. Even tiny little babies manifest the symptoms of the sin pox. And then you might say, well, surely an innocent little child can't be sinful. But I ask you, can an innocent little child be born with AIDS or a defective heart? Almost every disease comes with symptoms. And I realize that this new one we're dealing with, some, maybe they say even up to 80%, are asymptomatic, have no symptoms. But most diseases have some kind of symptoms or consequences of the disease. Maybe there is excessive thirst or fatigue or rapid weight loss or blurred vision. Because we are infected with this sin pox that courses through our veins, we are born with a natural drive toward evil. This is clearly evident even in the lives of little children. Do we have any parents here that have been parents before? A couple of you? So then you know that we have to teach children everything except sin. We teach them how to get dressed. We teach them how to speak. We teach them how to brush their teeth, how to take a bath, how to tie their shoes, how to ride a bike. However, did you notice that children never have to be taught how to do evil? Did you ever teach a child, boy, Johnny, let me tell you how to tell a big whopper, or how to lie, or to take something that doesn't belong to them? Didn't they just kind of say to themselves, I'll get into trouble if I tell the truth, so I better lie? Something inside that person told him to lie. Didn't he just see something that he wanted, and something inside of him told him to take it? I deserve that more than they do. Did you have to train your children to steal and to lie? It's inherent ability. Now, you can go through life if you want to and act like there's nothing wrong with you. You can live in denial if you please. Many people do that all the time. They notice this symptom or that symptom, but they don't want to hear the doctor pronounce the diagnosis, so they live in denial until one day they drop dead. The ultimate proof, though, that we are infected with the sin pox, that something is fatally wrong with this world, is death. Sin came into this world through one man, and death through sin. I believe that's what we just read in the epistle. And so we see that just like smallpox, the sin pox has spread from one person to another down through the centuries, infecting everyone, every man, woman, boy, and girl. You may think and say that it isn't fair when a little child dies from a disease, or some woman who volunteered to go to New York and help them with the fight and the COVID virus, and she selflessly gave herself away to care for those sick patients, and she became infected and died. But that's the way disease works. It pulls no punches. Disease has no sense of fairness. Plague doesn't distinguish between old or young or ugly or attractive, a good person or a bad person. Sin has no mercy, and it plans to take you down. Jesus said, the devil cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's his mission. Now, I reminded you of your disease-infected body. Thank you very much. But I want to tell you also this morning about the cure. As a matter of fact, humanity was so successful in their life and death struggle with the smallpox disease around the world that the disease has been virtually eliminated. The last case of natural smallpox occurred in Somalia in 1977. So smallpox, the most feared and devastating of all infectious diseases, was eliminated from the face of the earth. On May 8th of 1980, WHO, the World Health Organization, declared the world free of smallpox. But how did the world become free of smallpox? Or the smallpox virus, I should say. And I say that because it's really a deadly family of viruses, and some of them also infect animals. All creation is cursed with the pox virus. Cows died from what was called the cowpox. In 1796, Edward Jenner was a family physician who lived in southern England. And he noticed that every few years, when smallpox would sweep across the English countryside, that the women who milked cows, milkmaids, seemed to be spared from the infection that was infecting everybody else. So he reasoned that these women were getting infected when they came in contact with the blisters on the udders of the cows when they were milking the cows, and that this infection was protecting them from infection from smallpox. So he took fluid from the blisters of cows and injected that fluid, the pus, into several people, including his 15-month-old son, to see if that fluid protected against smallpox. And it worked. What Dr. Jenner had discovered is what we call a vaccine. According to the American Heritage Dictionary, a vaccine is, quote, a preparation of a weakened or killed pathogen, such as a bacterium or virus, or a portion of that pathogen structure that upon administration stimulates antibody production or cellular immunity against the pathogen, but is incapable of causing severe infection. So when a person takes a vaccine, his or her immune system responds by producing antibodies, substances that weaken or destroy disease-causing organisms. And so when that person is later exposed to live bacteria or viruses of the same kind that were in the vaccine, those antibodies are ready and they attack and kill those invading bacterium or virus quickly, thus preventing the person from getting sick. And that is why Jesus became infected with sin. God has made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, so that we might live immune to the effects of the sin pox by his death. Jesus carried that sin pox in his own body to the grave. It killed him, but it made us a vaccine. We are made immune to the effects of the sin pox, eternal death and separation from God. Instead, because he was raised from the dead, we shall also rise again to new life on that great resurrection morning. Now, many times you will hear the Centers for the Disease Control decry the falling immunization rates. We don't worry about smallpox anymore, right? And so some parents are like, what do I need that smallpox virus for, vaccine for? Or what do I need that for? I think it causes autism. And so they're called anti-vaxxers. You've heard of them, or it's only been me? But should there be a vaccine tomorrow for COVID-19, when it's an emergency and it's a hot topic, how many of you would sign up to get that vaccine if there was one out there? I know I would be one of the first ones down there. We had all those little shots when we were kids, the smallpox and the TB and all that. But sometimes when there's not one raging across the world, people put that vaccine on the back burner. Whatever the reason, immunization rates fall off until there's an outbreak, and then everyone rushes to get immunized. When the scare is over, people return to putting immunization on the back burner. Now, as great as the smallpox vaccine is, it can't help somebody who has already died of the smallpox disease. If you waited until you were infected with smallpox, you waited too long, It can't help a dead man. It won't restore you to life and health again. And so there are the similarities between the smallpox vaccine and the sinpox vaccine end. Because Jesus, the sinpox vaccine, specializes in dead men. Ephesians 2, 4 through 5. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. When we were dead in our sin, while our bodies and souls still oozed forth from sores of death and decay and all corruption, he himself bore our sins in his own body on that tree. So God shows his love for us in this, as the epistle says this morning, that even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were yet full of pockets of pus and rotting sores on a dead body, Christ gave himself over to the sinpox. Can you imagine being back in the day and finding out that somebody was covered with pockets of pus, or whether it was a smallpox, and then go lie down beside them and join them so you could get the disease? That's what Christ did. He joined us. He put on human flesh and walked among us and was infected by not ever sinning, but taking the penalty for our sin. Christ gave himself over to the penalty of the sinpox, to taste death for every man, to make us a vaccine in his own body and grant us new life in his resurrection. This is a picture of how one man's disease can kill everyone in sight, and how the dead viruses taken from one dead body can save the many. You've heard them talking about they want to get the plasma from people who've already recovered from COVID so they can inject it into other people and save their lives. Verse 15 today says, the free gift is not like the trespass. Many died through one man's trespass. Much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. The treatment is there if you want it. The vaccine is available to save you from the horrible fate that awaits all of those who die from the sinpox. Even though we are already dead in our trespasses and sin, we can be made alive again in Christ. Now, you could refuse to believe. You could remain in denial. And so many today in our world are thinking just that way. You can deny that anything is wrong or that you need any type of treatment. I'm fine. People deny symptoms all the time. Or you could confess your sins, believe in Christ's atonement, and know that if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. We're not going to pass the plate for the offering, but instead I think we have one as you exit to drop your offerings and tithing in. But we will stand and sing the offertory. What shall I render to the Lord? Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. I want to lift up or make known to you today that Linda Allen, whose adopted mom passed away yesterday, this is the grandmother of Lori Guidry that we have been praying for. Alvin's nephew, Matt Ogrodowitz, had a bad four-wheeler accident Friday night. He is having neck surgery at 2 p.m. today. Let's pray the surgeon will be with him, with the doctor and with him. Nancy's brother, Bill Tice. Your brother's name is Bill Tice? Thies. Because there's a lot of typhus around here in this part of Texas. And the lady, the one who's not here right now, but Danny Faye, Matthew, she's a typhus. And when she told us that she's a maiden named typhus, we're like, wow, there's lots of typhuses around here. And then to know this. But anyway, your brother, Bill Thies, who broke his leg and had surgery, pray for his recovery. Any other prayer requests that are not known or listed? Let's pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we offer before you our humble prayer for the well-being of your church throughout the world. Guide and govern it by your Holy Spirit, that all who profess themselves Christian be led into the way of truth and hold the Christian faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, in the righteousness of life. Lord, in your mercy, send down upon all ministers of the gospel and upon the congregations committed to their care the healthful spirit of your grace, that they please you in all things. Lord, in your mercy, behold in mercy all who are in authority over us. Supply them with your blessing, that they be inclined to your will and walk according to your commandments. Lord, in your mercy, we humbly ask your abiding presence in every situation, that you make known your ways among us. Preserve those who travel, satisfy the wants of your creatures, and help those who call upon you in any need, that they have patience in the midst of suffering, and according to your will, be released from their affliction. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we thank you for hearing our prayers this day and every day. We name before you this day our brothers and sisters who are struggling in body or mind and spirit, and ask for your strength, comfort, and healing. We lift up before you today Diane Bocci, Kim Priest, Gary Schmidt, Bill Schmidt, who had hernia surgery earlier this week, COVID-19 patients and caregivers, Louise Ogrodowitz, the Garza family, Sherry Gegelman, Pastor Kilm, Bernice Bates, Karen Bowles. This is kind of worded strangely. It says, we pray for birthday blessings to the flag of the United States and Barbara Gadd and the United States Army. Today is Flag Day, celebrates our flag. Barbara said she knows this is worded strangely, but it is the birthday of our flag, also the birthday of the U.S. Army, and her birthday. And she didn't want to be in the birthday list all by herself, so she added the flag. So it's worded strangely, but it's all the birthday of all those three things. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your great mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God. For you have mightily governed and protected your holy church, in which the blessed apostles and evangelists proclaimed your divine and saving gospel. Therefore, with prophets, apostles, and evangelists, with the holy church throughout the world, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we do laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And after he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." In the same way, when supper was ended, he took the cup. And after he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take and drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin. This do as often as you drink it, to remember me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
I will praise him, praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory on people, for his blood can wash away sin.
Take and eat the body of Christ, the body of Christ.
Body of Christ. The body of Christ for you. Take and eat the body of Christ. The body of Christ for you. Take and eat the body of Christ. The body of Christ for you. Take and eat the body of Christ. The body of Christ for you. The body of Christ. The body of Christ for you.
We rise for the post-communion canticle. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.